night. I stop at the stairs of the auxiliary building, deliberating for a moment between going to the dorms to get my books and stuff and going straight away to the class. Well, it's not yet lunchtime, right? So, yeah, there's still some time to spare. The sun stings my eyes, so I head towards the dorms. The halls are quiet as the courtyard walls. Naturally so, since everyone is in class. I knock lightly at the door of 3-3 and push open the door when Muto calls from the other side. Sorry, I'm late. 15 pairs of eyes turn to me. 15 pairs of eyes. Okay, that's basically 15 students. Good morning, Nakai. Muto seems to be somewhat confounded by my coming in late, as if I interrupted his flow or something. Judging from the rambling lectures his classes tend to be, that might be the case. I pass him the note the nurse gave me. Muto takes it with a nod and reads it quickly. He lifts his eyebrows and gives me a kind of a stern look, but doesn't say anything, just nods solemnly again. I shrug, and he gestures at me to run along, so I naturally do. The class goes on lazily. I think I'm starting to get into the rhythm of the school. I have even stopped worrying about taking notes and being overly attentive. The first days, I was pretty high strung in class. Muto, finishing his lecture about electricity early, but continues without a pause about the festival.
So, as you know, the festival is on the day after tomorrow. I hope everyone's projects are going to be successful this year. Have a good time, but also come Sunday. Please keep the meaning of this festival in your minds.
Can't wait for the festival. I wonder how the festival is going to be like. Is it something like the Japanese, you know, the traditional Japanese shrine festival, that kind with all the stalls and all the, you know, the games, like the koi fishing, yeah, and the gun. Using a gun to shoot the targets and those kind of games and food, yakitori on that, or nostalgia. Oh, you see.
Games and fried food!
Everyone bursts out in laughter, as so do I.
Yes, thank you, Ricardo. But what I meant was more the
The remaining of his sentence is buried beneath the ring of the lunch bells, and everyone starts packing their things. Muto deliberates for a moment, but since almost nobody seems to pay attention anymore, he gives up and sits down. Oh, it's crowded in the hallway, or as crowded as hallways in this school probably get. Most of the students seem to be heading down for the cafeteria, and this is the first time we actually see a crowd. I mean, like, in the cafeteria you just see an empty place, but we don't have this kind of crowd. So, alright. Normally, I would join the flow and grab a lunch myself, but today is different because we're going to see Amy, oh yeah! Today, I've been invited to lunch on the roof, an odd location, but that's where I was told to go. No, it's not really an odd location, because in anime tropes, yeah, the classic place to have lunch, one of the classic places to have lunch, is the roof. Fortunately, I managed to find shelter from the storm in the lee of the classroom door. Finally, it's quiet. Eventually, the torrent subsides, and I step tentatively out into the hallway. Only to be met by Amy, who comes flouncing down the hallway like a cannonball.
Hey, sir. Great timing.
And this is the first time we see Amy in her school uniform. Oh yeah, she looks equally cute in her school uniform, so yeah.
I have super extra lunch today, as promised. Let's go upstairs.
The stairway to the roof is a little dilapidated, but it's clearly been used recently. At the top of the stairs is a door, complete with missing padlock. I wonder who the intrepid individual was that removed the lock. Well, probably Amy.
Oh, we get the breeze. Oh, nice. Oh, let me just take a look at the background for a moment. The background looks kind of weird though.
I mean the floor anyway. The floor like doesn't seem to gel in with the the fences and all that looks kind of weird, weird perspective, but okay. Okay, we'll just take it as it is. Amy shoves the door open and steps, beaming into the sunlight. Oh, and who's that? Ah, I think I know who that is. Suddenly, a tall, dark stranger appears out of nowhere, standing imposingly in front of us. Amy flinches back, almost falling back down the stairs.
Eek!
Hello?
Yips! You scared me, Rin!
Wait, isn't she... Hello? Noticing that Rin is speaking to me, Amy looks curiously at me.
You two know each other?
I look confusedly at Amy. She's that friend of yours? Rin has turned her gaze towards the clouds drifting above the school.
I didn't know you knew this person, Amy.
That's kind of awkward now. The awkward silence lasts only for a few seconds until Amy lets out a tiny giggle, shrugging the coincidence off.
I invited his son for lunch. If you know him, that's just better. Oh, does that mean I don't get food? Or did you invite him for lunch without the lunch?
What?
neither. I have food for three.
Nice thinking. They walk to the other end of the roof while I stay at the clock tower for a while, taking in the atmosphere. Oh yeah. There is nobody else but us here. I guess the roof is not as popular as it is in other schools. A few rundown benches and tables are scattered around the edges, perhaps in an attempt to make the rooftop look less desolate. The small pebbles covering the roof rattle beneath our feet. Oh, so those are pebbles, okay. Got it. I peek through the chain link fence to take a look at the school grounds and beyond. Students are strolling in pairs and groups around the quadrangle and at the cafeteria. A few delivery trucks are driving past the school towards the convenience store nearby. Somewhere, a watchdog barks at a passerby. Somehow, when I look towards the town center, the small town feel strikes me very strongly, almost palpably. The hectic lifestyle of big metropolises seems so far away and foreign here. Nobody has to run to catch a bus like their life dependent on it, or get their senses overloaded by the neon lights and traffic jams. I feel surprisingly optimistic about this new life of mine. Looking at my new hometown, even if it's going to be mine for only one short year, well, it's definitely a nice change, you know. Always good to, you know, break away from the busy lifestyle and all. Finding out about my illness and having to move away from home all came so suddenly, I haven't had time to think about how I feel about it. When I step out of the shadow of the clock tower to the open, I feel warmth touching my back. The sun shines from a perfectly clear, cerulean sky. Okay, now that I think about it, I mean, after reading through a lot of these lines, I like how this story always likes to be very poetic, you know. Like, you know, describe things in a very sophisticated manner. Which I can appreciate, you know. Yeah, I can definitely appreciate. Yeah, it's a nice change. Well, because usually most visual novels don't have, or most stories that I read don't have this kind of, poetry and all that. So, it's a nice change, you know. A cool breeze sweeping over the rooftop makes me shiver, but only briefly. The wind carries the scent of trees and flowers, not smoke and car exhaust like it used to just a few weeks ago. Amy settles on a bench with Rin in tow and produces one big and two small lunch boxes from her bag.
Come on, Isel. What are you waiting for?
She's beckoning me to join them, making room on the already small bench. Oh, now you're pretty close. I seat myself on the corner of the bench to take as little space as possible. It's pretty cramped, but somehow all three of us fit on it. Impressive view. Amy suppresses a giggle and places a lunchbox in front of me, and hands another lunchbox to me.
Here you go, go. Lunch as promised.
Homemade, no less. I'm impressed. Nice bento. Wow, this looks really good.
Thanks. I made it myself when I can.
Conversation dies off as I set about the business of feeding myself. Taking a few bites, I glance up and notice Rin deftly opening the lunchbox with her feet and popping a fork full of food into her mouth using only her feet. Even though I've seen it before, I can't help but be impressed at her dexterity. It's also a reminder of the sort of place I am in right now. Will I ever get used to sights such as this? I can't decide if getting used to such a thing would be a good thing or a bad thing either. Does getting used to this place means that I'm giving up on being a normal person? I'm not sure about that though. I mean, you're just... barring the condition that you have. I mean, you're still living a normal life, you know, so to speak. Yeah. Or does it just mean that I'm becoming more understanding about those around me? I'm distracted from my thoughts by the sight of Amy tearing into a lunch as if it had insulted her ancestors. what kind of sentence is this? Insulted her ancestors? Okay. You seem pretty hungry. Oh, okay. I think I know what it means by that line. Because, I mean, in Japanese context, there's this thing called itadakimasu. So, itadakimasu is something that you say, you know, to give respects. Yeah, before you eat. So I guess why he said like this insulting ancestors is that because Amy didn't say like itadakimasu or something like that, and then just straight away indulge in her food, you know, just gobble the food, so a bit rude there. So that's why the term insult, you know, her ancestors or something like that. Yeah. Amy looks up, mouth half full, and swallows before nodding.
My morning run always wakes up an appetite. Which is great, because then I burn through lunch pretty quickly. Helps me keep my girlish figure.
Yeah, you definitely have a girlish figure, Amy. Or is it girly? Either way it works.
What would happen if you lose it? Would you become a man?
I definitely choke my lunch, trying not to laugh. I don't know what to make of that though.
It's a figure of speech? Does your figure have to run in the mornings too?
Do you always talk like this?
Oh, talk like what? Like what?
I'm talking to Rin though. I think that answers my question. never mind. So, I struggle to think of small talk and settle on the obvious question. How did you two meet? Rin seems content to let Amy answer this question.
Someone in the housing department thought that we would complement each other well, so we were assigned rooms next to one another.
That reminds me, so basically Hisa was assigned room next to Kenji because they think Kenji and Hisa will get along. I don't know. Maybe complement each other.
Like shoes and a suit,
huh? Wait, shoes and a suit. Okay. I get it now. Because Amy has no legs, and Rin has no arms, so the combination of the two means they form as one. Yeah, you get it. Get it. Yeah, basically, Amy forms Rin's hands, and Rin forms Amy's legs. That sort of thing, you know. Huh? Amy giggles at my confusion.
Put us together, and we've got all our limbs, get it? See?
There we go. Ah, okay.
So I started helping Rin get ready in the mornings. That was that. I mean, you can't help someone get dressed every morning and not get along.
I see. Rin chooses this moment to interject.
I have trouble with shirts.
Right, that seems fairly obvious.
Really?
Kind of? This isn't helping, but at least Amy seems to find the whole thing funny. That, combined with the fact that Rin is genuinely curious, makes me feel slightly better and yet confused. I mean, you've got no arms, so putting on a shirt seems like one of those things that would be difficult. You know what? I'm going to just stop talking now. Yeah, you stop being so insensitive, you know. You saved me a lot of trouble in the long run. Read not in what I suspect is meant to be a sage manner. I see. The conversation dies as I turn my attention back to my lunch. It's really quite good. Amy finishes the lunch first and makes a contented noise. That was good. As she busies herself with cleaning up her lunch, Rin speaks up. I'm thirsty.
Oh, I almost forgot about that. Sorry.
With a flourish, she reaches into her bag and removes a trio of juice boxes. Well prepared, Amy. Well prepared. You're definitely the perfect waifu. She tosses me one that appears to be cranberry juice, one to Rin that appears to be some kind of strawberry milk, complete with pink color scheme, and keeps an equally pink box of some kind of fruit punch for herself. Rin dexterously steps her straw through the top of her box and begins to drink. I'm once again impressed by how flexible she is, but this time I keep my comment to myself. Somehow, I don't think either Amy or Rin are the sorts of people to think twice about the way they work around their particular disabilities. Rin especially so. I should come to think of it. Now, you see, we have Amy and Rin, they are compatible with each other. Then, by right, you know, Shizune, the deaf and mute girl, and Lily, the blind girl, should also complement each other, right? Because Lily will become, you know, Shizune's voice, and Shizune will become Lily's sight. Yeah, but apparently, nah, that's not the case. So anyway, indeed, she gives off the impression of being entirely unaware that she's missing any limbs at all. Whether or not that's a conscious decision is another matter. I'm honestly not sure.
So, Hisao, how do you like it up here?
It's quite nice, actually. I like high places for the view. Thanks for inviting me up here. And for the lunch, too. Amy grins a 1000-watt grin. Pleased by my response, I suppose.
No problem. Feel free to eat with us next time too, okay? I will make you a lunch, but you can bring your own up here.
No lunch service? I don't know. You're trying to play something, he saw. Amy looks more offended. You're trying to be funny there.
Trying to take advantage of my good nature? The nerve!
She giggles.
Well, if that's your answer, I guess Rin and I will just keep eating lunch or don't.
Oh no, don't say that, Amy, no! I'm suddenly assaulted by the most heartrending puppy dog eyes I've ever seen, as Amy pops. No, don't give me that look. No. Kidding. I was kidding. I would love to eat lunch up here again. Good location, and the company's okay too. Amy frowns a bit at my declaration of okay, but seems happy enough that I've accepted her invitation. I guess this makes us friends now, or at least acquaintances. The lunch bell rings, signaling a return downstairs.
Rin, you didn't finish your lunch again. I wasn't that hungry. You ain't gonna eat more, you're gonna fade away.
Fade away? Rin shrugs, as if this is an acceptable risk. Come on, we better get along. Alright, the three of us head down the stairs together. Alright, back to the classroom. Alright, the afternoon class passes. Once again, I find myself without a plan for something to do after school, so I head to the library to return a couple of the books I finished reading. And we're gonna meet Hanako again, oh yeah, my main girl. I hope. Walking inside, I see that there are about as many students here as there were on Tuesday. all the more evident from the almost total silence enveloping the room. Oh, and that's Yuko, right? As I drop the books I have borrowed into the return slot in the counter, Yuko suddenly pops up from behind it, quite startled from the banging they make as they hit a trolley next to her. Ah, sorry, I didn't mean to startle you there, you know?
No, that's fine. It happens a lot. I'm used to it by now.
But apparently not.
Can I help you?
It's okay. I think I know where everything is. Thanks anyway. I'm going to look for Kanako. Let's go. I suppose I'll grab another book or two while I'm here. There's not much else to do, and after reading so much during my stay in the hospital, it's become a hard habit to break. I wander down to the fiction section towards the back of the library, scanning the bookshelves for anything that catches my eye. As I do, I look over to the corner where Hanako had been the last time I was here, not really expecting anything to come of it. But there she is. Surprisingly though, she's there, absorbed completely in a fairly thick book. I decide against intruding on her like last time and get back to finding reading material. Oh, you're not gonna approach her?
Why not?
Come on. After an indiscernible amount of time spent perusing the Aces, I finally decide on a couple of books to get and slide them off the shelf. With a minimum of fuss, I quickly walk over to the counter, check out my books, and pop them into my bag as I walk out. Oh no, why you leave Hanako alone? No! Come on, Issa, what are you doing? Damn it! I want to get to know Hanako more, man. By the time I leave the main building, sunset isn't too far away. A small trickle of students remain, but the majority have left, presumably to their homes and dorms. Feeling utterly drained, I head to my room to read the books I borrowed. There's been enough action and excitement for one day already. The first is Alice Adventures in Wonderland. I know the story, of course, but I've never actually read the original book. It's just as trippy as I remember the story to me, with the wacky characters and nonsense plot. I start thinking of myself as some sort of an Alice too, haplessly tumbling down the rabbit hole into this creeper wonderland. Okay, that's a rather strong expression. Still, the isolated location and the overt way the school accommodates to absolutely everything is unsettling. It's like another world. I wonder why I can't shake the feeling of being an outsider like Alice, despite most everyone being so hospitable and friendly with me. Turning another page, my mind started drifting further away from the book. It's quiet. I can hear my heartbeat thumping against the fabric of my shirt. For some reason, it makes me feel really bad, like it has since that time in the forest with Iwana. Like I was locked in a cage with something nasty and scary. I put the book down for a while and stare at the ceiling, taking my time to shake off the feeling. 200 pages later, I fall asleep. Alright, there. Come on, I need to get to know Hanako more. Come on. Give me more moments with Hanako. Come on. The students roll into class for the Saturday morning session, each and every one of them spotting the tired eyes of people who have worked through the night. With only a day left to prepare, I suppose it's not so surprising. Thankfully, we only have to suffer through classes until the lunch break, and then our time is our own. Moto lurches into class in a tired stagger. I suppose students aren't the only people here that enjoy their late Friday nights. Without saying a word, he scrawls some page and question numbers on the board and slumps down at his desk. And you're gonna sleep? Even a teacher sleeps. It's a completely atypical behavior for him, but it appears that no one in the class is gonna call him out on it. Wordlessly, the students shuffle their textbooks into position and get to work. Not wanting to break the trend, I do the same. Fatigue has made the class antisocial. Not a peep is heard among the ruffling papers. That can partly be attributed to the two empty seats beside me. Oh, for some reason, Misha and Shizune aren't present. Probably doing council work for the festival. It's very quiet without Misha present. I wonder if she was born as rowdy as she is, or if she's making up for Shizune's lack of voice. Who knows?
Nakai, can I speak to you for a moment?
I'm so engrossed in thinking about Misha that I don't even notice Moto approaching my desk.
Sure. What's this about?
It's probably better if we speak outside the classroom.
You mean about my condition?
Something about this doesn't sound too good, but I stand up and follow him out into the hallway.
Muto stands in the hallway, scratching his head as he works out what he's trying to say. Not knowing what's going on, I wait silently.
I heard from the school's head nurse that you had an incident the other day, alright.
Alright, yeah, it's about that. Incident and the condition. So it's about that. Well, kind of, but it's not anything to be worried about.
Yes, yes, it is. Anything that can endanger your health is something to be worried about. We try our best here to prepare you for life here. Part of that involves knowing your limits and how to work around them. It would be remiss of me if I didn't speak up about this.
Alright, I get it. I'm sorry. Muto closes his eyes in frustration, and I realize that this probably wasn't the best thing to say.
Something tells me that you're not sorry. Pretend as much as you want, but this isn't a normal school. A lot of people have put in a lot of time, effort, and money to make sure that you and every other student here can have the same level of education as your peers. For you to abuse that by throwing out advice, especially medical advice, is plain selfish.
I'm not quite sure if this is actually how he feels, or if it is some act that he's practiced many times to guilt trip students into doing the right thing. Either way, it's working. I understand. This is all new to me, and I apologize. I know my limits now, and I'll be sticking to them. Moto appears to lighten up a little, satisfied that his message has been received.
So then, on to my next question. How are you finding your studies? I understand you were laid up for a while. We're not too far ahead, are we?
I don't really think so. I tried to keep up when I was in the hospital, but so it hasn't been too hard. Muto taps his chin and raises an eyebrow as he absorbs this information.
Is that so? I suppose there's still students out there who realize the importance of learning.
I wouldn't go that far. I was only trying to keep myself occupied in my little life support prison. Well, yeah, you've got to keep up with these things, right?
That's exactly it. One wrong move in this world and you're left behind, right?
Right. Wouldn't want that to happen.
No, you wouldn't. Every week, there's a new scientific theory, or rather scientific discovery. Most of them mean nothing to the layperson, but any one of them could be the key to the next big thing.
Yeah, I'll keep that in mind. It's obvious that Muto's serious talk is over, and he's gone back to his standard, slightly scatterbrained approach to life. I think in hindsight, that I prefer him this way. Yeah, the relaxed type. He's slightly more predictable in his unpredictability.
Well then, I think that's all I really have to say. Let's get back inside, shall we?
My relief as that suggestion is surmountable.
Sure. You're the boss, right? You call the shots.
Muto pauses for a moment.
I don't think any of my students has ever said that to me before.
For instance, I consider replying to this, but something deep within me tells me to shut my mouth and get back into the classroom. A few of the students jump at the sound of the door, rapidly trying to pretend that they are working on the questions on the board. Some don't even bother, their heads slumped on the desk as they nap. Thankfully, it would appear that Muto does not even notice them. He returns to his desk and retrieves a scientific journal from one of the drawers. I guess I got to him here. There. The class returns to the near silence that Muto and I left it before our chat. Mixed feelings of tiredness and anticipation buzz around the room. Everyone here is either waiting for a chance to rest or the chance to get their last minute preparations underway. The clock on the wall slowly ticks the remaining class time away until finally the bells cry out, ending the torment.
Before you all leave, I expect the answers for those problems by Monday.
Actually, I think at this point, by the way, just a bit off track, but at this point, I think there's no hope for me to get either Misha or Shizune really, because I've already blown the chance, you know, to get them to recruit Hisao to the student council. So no hope to get those two girls really. But it's okay because my focus is on Harako. So yeah. The class sighs as one, instantly regretting slacking off, but still acutely aware of the more pressing issues at hand. The classroom empties in a blink as everyone rushes to their last minute festival preparations. I stay behind and try to quickly finish the questions so I don't have to bother with it over the rest of the weekend, with the festival and all tomorrow. Oh, and there's Hanako. Yes, bonding time! Apart from me, Hanako is the only one left, obviously waiting for Lily. It's weird that Lily comes all the way to our classroom to pick her up. I expect that moving around is at least nominally harder for her than it is for Hanako. Yeah, good point there. Actually, Hanako should be the one to look for Lily and not the other way around. But it's none of my business, and I naturally don't ask about it from Hanako. Why is it none of your business? Despite the relative proximity of our seats, neither tries to strike up a conversation about that or anything else either. So an oppressive silence falls upon the classroom. Time passes in silence. It's probably just 15 minutes or so, but it feels longer. I turn pages of my notebook. Hanako turns pages of the novel she's reading. My pencil lead splinters against the paper just when I was about to finish a paragraph. The sounds of my irritated sigh and subsequent fumbling around for a sharpener feels like they're breaking the mood in the classroom. Hanako keeps her eyes firmly away from my direction. Before long, Lily's tall figure appears in the doorway.
Hanako?
In the instant she hears Lily's voice, Hanako rushes to Lily. Her name is all it takes to make Hanako jump up from her desk and run to Lily. They talk quietly for a moment, but it isn't long before Lily leaves down the hall and Hanako idles back into the classroom, taking her seat once again. I watch Hanako out of the corner of my eye out of sheer curiosity at the idea that the two will be separated. For a couple of minutes, she does nothing but sit with her chin in her hand, staring at the desk dejectedly. What's going on? Why aren't you with Lily? The boredom evidently becomes too much for her though, her slender frame reaching into her back and pulling out a small book. Come to think of it, that isn't the one I saw her reading at the library. She must be quite a fast reader to get through them at this rate. After about 10 minutes of restlessly shuffling in her seat and trying to read, Hanako closes her book and leaves too. As should I, since the assignment is all but finished and there is nothing else to do in the classroom. Not that I have anything to do anywhere else either. The school is a beehive of activity, but nobody pays me any heed. I saunter past classrooms filled with students, frantically doing this and that, buzzing around like little worker bees. Now at this point, I feel like I'm being left out though. Like, I'm scared that I made wrong choices, that I will end up with the bad end, like not ending up with any of the girls. I hope that's not the case, you know. I'm doing a good job right now, I hope. You wouldn't guess the school day is over. Wow, still very crowded. It's a bit quieter outside, but not by much. People zip by, left and right, hurrying as quickly as they can, busy and energetic. I feel the opposite. The midday sun seems to be draining all the spirit out of my body, making it feel limp all over. Warm, soft air flows inside my shirt, feeling like a cushion. I yawn lazily, thinking about what I would do. I'll drop off my books at the dorms first, and then something I haven't decided yet. Oh, another choice? Maybe Kenji is in his room. Why? We're looking for him? No! On the way to the dorms, I spot Amy coming my way, running despite not having those weird running prosthetics on. Oh, she's not wearing the prosthetics?
I wave at her and she hits the stop. Yo, Hisao!
Spatters of white and green paint adorn her nose and chin respectively, but her smile is wide, as it seems it always is. She leans closer to me, amplifying the feeling she is examining me.
What you doing?
Nothing really. I don't have anything to do for the festival, and everyone else seems to be doing something important.
That's perfect. They can help me, I mean.
With the festival preparations? Yeah, I'm not sure if I would be of much help.
That's fine. I'm not much help either.
Amy grabs my wrist and starts dragging me back inside the school quite forcefully. Even her walking speed is more like jogging, making me stumble over myself simply trying to keep up. The stairs slows Amy down a little bit. Maybe it's hard to climb with her legs, or maybe she's finally running out of breath. We go all the way back to the third floor, into the seniors' hallway, ending up where I left 5 minutes ago. I could just as well have stayed here waiting for Amy, had I known. So are you... Is Min working on that mural still?
That's right. She needs all kinds of paints and brushes and stuff, so I went to get them from the art classroom.
And you need me to help with that?
Well, Min told me you already had, you had already helped her, so I thought you wouldn't mind.